What do you think of when you think of the word missions? Is it strictly just some far out project that people do in effort to just grab a hold of people's hearts and lives and make them see life in a different way, spiritually as well as mentally? Or is it something a little more broad? Think about that for a minute. I think it's very interesting how missions, it's sometimes a little more out there and not always something we kind of think it's something that anyone can do. Is it that? In this new series, I'm going to take a look at what makes these people tick and keep on keeping on. I'm also going to take a look at exactly what kinds of people they minister to, the types of audiences, and what it takes and what's necessary when it comes to ministering to those types of groups. As you'll see, not one is the same, but it's all for the same purpose. I think you'll find this very interesting and something that will even enlighten my mind. Hopefully it does yours. Your guidebook on how to survive missions starts now. Involving this series will take place. Over the next few months, we'll be exploring people, caring for people, getting to know people, investing in people, and really dealing with things that really matter. Things that would make things like this completely irrelevant. So join me as we now turn the page to chapter 1. And to kick things off, we go 422 miles east of TCS Films HQ to a Illinois town of Sycamore, Illinois, where we bring in our first person from Cadre Ministries, Dave Garda. And Dave, I gotta tell ya, we've known each other actually for a long time. If you care to, I'm having trouble trying to remember how we first met. Do you recall?
Oh, I sure do recall. Since your dad and I were friends in high school, I've known you from before you were actually out of your mother's womb. So I think I've known you your entire life, Taylor.
No wonder I don't remember.
That's right. You were a little too young when I first met you. You were way too young to remember.
I don't know about that, because I do remember like a few things that repetitively happened, per se, in my life. Like, the continuous visit to Hardee's, or the fire alarm always going off, maybe the slightest bit of smoke in our Iowa home back in the day. But, you know.
Well, do you remember your bottle and your diaper, though? I mean, we have to think way back if we got to think that far.
I can only remember all the way back to pull-ups.
Gotcha.
I remember diapers before that. I can only remember that far back. And by the way, viewers, I don't wear those anymore. So,
good.
So we know each other for that long, and it's so funny because my parents actually had you as my godparents, but never once have you given me an offer I couldn't refuse. I found that pretty ironic. So let's get back to the... Okay, let's get back to the main topic of conversation here. First off, Cadre, define and explain.
Absolutely. Cadre is the name of a missionary agency that I'm a part of that exists to encourage volunteers in every church in the globe to live as disciple makers in their family and friendships. But the word cadre itself is a word that means a small group of people committed to the same mission who all bring their own talent and gift. The Army uses the term cadre when the military takes different branches of the military partnering with a single mission. So that might be by sea, by air, by land, and they all do what they do best, but they accomplish a single purpose from their own strengths. So that's what a cadre is.
That's kind of funny, because I actually did, when I was doing my pre-interview prep work, and yes, I do that, I actually did look at the definition of cadre. Here is the literal definition. I think this is Merriam-Webster. A nucleus or core group, especially trained personnel, able to assume control to train others. For example, a group of people having some unifying relationship. Like you say, a cadre of brothers, a cadre of lawyers.
A band of brothers, absolutely.
Precisely. So, but what does a small group per se, how is that absolutely essential to your work?
Oh, great question, Kyler. Caleb. The key
he called
here,
me Tyler. His grandson Tyler is upstairs in the room.
He's hanging out with me today, so sorry. a great example would be at the very core of every Christian's relationships from the Bible needs to be friends who, when we follow Jesus together, we're more than what we would be if we followed Jesus alone. And everybody needs those kinds of friendships. And it's interesting that Jesus never sent out individuals to carry out his mission. He always sent out bands of brothers, pairs of friends. Matter of fact, there's a great Hebrew word, and that word is haver, and it's the word friend. And the style of learning that Jesus did with his disciples is called havrim. It's learning where friends gather to help each other. And so at the very, very core of everything we do in Cadre is making sure people don't follow Jesus alone, that their relationship with God is within the context of their family and their friendships, and everybody contributes to each other's relationship with God, sharing what they're learning, praying for each other, praying with each other, loving each other, being loved by each other, supporting each other. It's the art of encouragement and building each other up. Is a very mutual sport. And so that's at the very essence of how a cadre works, and it's at the very essence of the concept of disciple-making, is this idea of haver or friend. It's at the very core of what Jesus did.
Haver. I don't think I've ever heard that word before. Of course, I'm not necessarily the utmost expert in terms of Hebrew words, but... Right. Haver, that kind of sounds like a little bit of a kind of a friendship distribution, kind of, I don't know if borrowing is a good way to put it, but you can have this, and you can have this, and you can have this, and just kind of, I don't know, like a, it all works in a combination together, something like that, I don't know.
You know what, I'll give you the phrase, mutual community. And it's, you know, if there was a pop machine, and the pop machine was empty, or didn't have the flavor you wanted, and you go, forget it, I'm gonna go find another machine, right? Versus the idea of mutual community says, oh, the machine's empty. I'm gonna stock the machine for my friend, and I'm gonna ask him, what flavor would you like? If it's empty, I'm not just gonna move on. I'm gonna actually try to solve the problem so that we're all cared for. I love that in havering, making haver a verb, we wanna add this concept of mutual. That it isn't just one person taking from the other. It's not a download. It's a friendship.
I'm so used to where we have usually multiple vending machines these days. But you can still not find exactly what you want. Like, yeah. All these are like sodas, and I want cran grape juice.
Right? Well,
so like, but I get what you're saying. Like, you can always find a friend who would say, oh, yeah, I mean, and you want to drink healthier. Hey, you have some juice.
Absolutely. But it's, Jesus sent them out in pairs. Paul and Barnabas, when they went on their missionary journey, it's fun to watch their relationship, investing in each other, strengthening, building each other up, going together. to me, we've just, as Western Christians, we've just done way too much of our Christian life alone. And not enough in friendships. I can, by the way, I consider family a very special kind of friendship. When I say friendship, I would include families, spouses, parents with their children, creating the same kind of community, but never limited to a single household. Because the idea of haver is each family would have other families of friends, or each couple would have other couples, or each single would have other singles, all that would lean into making each other successful. It wouldn't be family only or friend only. It would be family and friends. That's probably go back to Deuteronomy chapter 6, where it says, you, your children, your grandchildren. So we get three generations. And then we get the idea of love the Lord your God with all your heart, mind, soul, and strength, and live this way wholeheartedly. And then it says, from the time you get up in the morning till you go to bed, teach this to your children as you walk along the way, and then in your house and inside the gate. And it's not the gate to your yard. It's not Leave It to Beaver. It's the gate of the city. And the idea was, live this way with those that are in your family, but also those that are in your school or job or career, your neighbors. And then Jesus spins that as love your neighbor as yourself. The idea of this Good Samaritan story. So it's your family and your friendships, those close to you and those in your job. And it's just, friendship should be the glue. And when you add God into that friendship, you have a thing called haver. You have us sharing our friendship with God with each other. That's at the very core of being a cadre, and the very core of what Jesus asked every Christian to do in the Great Commission. To go make disciples meant to go share what you knew about Jesus and draw other people in. Not just keep it to yourself. It's not just personal. You know, it's funny. God died for us, and it's a personal relationship, but it's not a private one. There's a community, the church, friendship, family, that's supposed to come around us. So our concept of cadre is we've got to stop doing so much alone and start letting the cadre work for us. Work together, mutual community, friendship. Kind of what we're doing today with all of the years of friendship we have, coming together to share and learn together.
Wasn't it in Genesis when God said, it is not good for man to be alone?
Absolutely, the creation of Adam.
Exactly.
And more than just Eve. Exactly. It's the very essence of God walked in the garden with Adam and Eve. The idea, the picture,
yes,
is he created us for community with him. So you're at the... Caleb, you went right to the core. It's right at the beginning. Matter of fact, the next book written in the history, the oldest book in the Bible that was written, the one that was written first, is the book of Job. And is interesting that the book of Job opens with the story of Job and his family, and then after all the crisis and loss, friends come and spend 6 days sitting quietly sharing the pain of Job, and then the rest of the book are friends and Job going back and forth, bantering back and forth with what they know of God and what must be happening. Friendship in crisis, and then Job and his wife are there. And so you get these, it's just a beautiful picture, oldest book written, has this idea of havering at the core of revealing a relationship with God to each other.
How difficult then would it be for someone entering a new community to kind of enter, per se, a new local community of havers? I mean, if our internet-connected world now, it's easy to connect electronically like we are now. But a little more harder to do it, say, on a face-to-face basis, which I still think is very important.
Absolutely.
What would be...
You know what? I think both and are valuable, not either or. Probably the best concept I can share with that is the idea of Legos. And, you know, the Duplo blocks are the little kid Legos, you know, the toddler Legos. And they have 4 to 8 snap-on points on them. And they're these big chunks, but once they're snapped, there's no more room. And I think that a lot of times what happens in a local group, a college ministry, a church, a Sunday school class, a small group, is that everybody there already has all their Legos snapped up, and they don't have any room for any new friendships. So we have room to be friendly, but it takes a degree of maturity to go, well, wait a minute. Here's somebody who's not snapped on, we need to adjust our relationships to make room for them. And in the Bible, that would be normal. The expectation would be for us to engage everybody in the body at some level. But in our Western world, we tend to snap up, make sure we're cared for, and then we stop looking around to see if anybody's being missed. And part of the concept of cadre and mutual community is the maturity of a community to look around and see who's not connected and to actually adjust our friendships to make room. Now, that means somebody's going to have to initiate. Someone's going to have to actually be mature enough to not just look out for themselves. But, and that's where I guess the challenge comes. The command's there to make room. We just don't always have the discipline to do it. Something we've watched, instead of taking all that Jesus has wrapped into this disciple-making friendship, a lot of churches or people or ministries or small groups get excited about one piece of it. And again, it's like getting excited about the tail of the elephant and missing the rest of the elephant.